Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm welcoming you today. I'm Dr. Anna Maria Temple, and we are here to do an awesome presentation about roadblocks to eczema. I want to introduce you to a few folks before we get started. This is my handsome husband, Hello. John Temple, and you'll see another beautiful couple across from us, well, sideways, really. This is the Kingdon family, Lindsay, who is, of course, his health coach, and Todd, who is her husband, and they're joining us tonight so we can talk to y'all about some of the obstacles that we faced in our families and in our relationships and in our children's healing with eczema to help you achieve success. But before we get started talking, I thought we'd do a little icebreaker and do a couple of little questions and polls to kind of get to know you all. Thank you so much for doing the questionnaire as you registered. And the question, if you haven't done it, the question was, what is your biggest obstacle? And there were several choices. It was dads, finances, grandparents, or picky eaters. And I would say 100% of participants picked dads.
Come on.
Dads. So thank you so much, dads, for being here, because this clearly...
Poor dads everywhere.
So we're going to start with the first one. And I would love to know, what brings you guys here? I'm not calling out names, but you know, are you here on the webinar for your child's eczema, for your own battle? We have several adults in the course, and then we also have actually several health professionals taking the course. So I was wondering if you guys don't mind putting in your answers for the poll so we can see who is attending this webinar. That'd be great. Well, it looks like we have a lot of parents. Thank you so much. And the next thing that I wanted to ask you guys, and we're going to go in the chat box, I would love to know where everybody is from. Just put in either, you don't have to put your city, just the state that you're from, so we can see, you know, how far we're reaching. Mm-hmm. Folks, our mission here together is to transform 10,000 children's lives in the next 12 months. So I would love to see where you guys are from, if you feel comfortable to put it in the chat box, where you're from or not. I think we're seeing it. Oh, there we go. Oh, South Carolina, yay. Neighbors to us, North Carolina. Oh, sweet. Very helpful when we do North Carolina, because then I could also help you with seasonal allergies and other things. So it's nice to know. So we have more folks from North Carolina. That's fantastic. Give a couple more minutes. Oh, Charlotte, Canada. That's amazing. Fantastic. Welcome, everybody. We're super excited. All right. And while you put a lot more people putting some stuff in, excellent. As you're putting that in, I want to give you what their next question is. These are all actually going to tie in. Over the past week, I want you to think of the one word that best describes how you've been feeling over the past week. If you could put that in the chat box, and could be frustrated, stressed, worried, happy, sad, angry. And I'm going to bring it back.
We need to put ours in.
To you. There you go. Ahead.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good one. Isolated. That's a good one. Oh, frustrated. Good one.
Good.
Over. Yeah.
Is that too honest?
Yeah.
Overwhelmed. Yep.
That's a good one. And it's good to get these words out. Over it. Another one. Yep. See, somebody second you. Over it. It's good to get these words out, because it is a lot. I'm sensing a lot of negativity happening over the past about a week and a half. Yeah. Isolated. Mm-hmm. And it seems like it's turning to very negative. So I wanted to acknowledge that and understand that, which is going to be followed by the last poll, and then we are going to move on. So the last poll is, okay, when passing by reflective surface, do you use it to see if anyone is following you? Do you use it to check yourself? Doesn't everyone else? Or do you use to contemplate the deeper meaning of life?
I don't know if we can answer.
Oh, no, hold on. I didn't publish it. Oh, sorry about that. I don't think.
Oh, we're not allowed to answer.
We're not allowed to answer.
That's great.
Yeah. We were trying to.
There we go. Oh, did it end?
Yeah, publish was when you tell. Yeah, so sorry.
Oh, no. What did you do?
I tried to answer. Sorry. See, dads are the problem, clearly.
It is not going to work out. It seemed like it worked out before. Can you guys see it? I'm not sure if you guys can see it. Anyway, all right, this may not be working out. The point of the whole thing is that I'm trying to bring light to the situation. Oh, look, everyone checks themselves out. See? Oh, yeah, there we go. The meaning of like, all right, somebody's going to, yes. It's a dad. The whole point of that is that we are so stressed and frustrated, especially with what's been going on over the past 9 weeks and 3 months. And we're not understanding how the stress that we are under is actually affecting our immune system. The more stressed we are, the lower our immune system function is. Therefore, the more likely we are to have issues like eczema or have problems with COVID-19. And I'm trying to bring light to the situation because our course is more than just what food we're going to remove and what cream we're going to put on. It is a mind-body connection because the whole human is connected. It is not just one thing. It is a whole puzzle, and we have to take into account our circumstance and not just pollen, but also the toxicity that's surrounding us. So it is important to have both parents on board, and that's why our dads are here, and I'm so grateful you guys are here, because when the whole family is not on board, it makes the journey 1,000 times more difficult. So I'm going to stop talking, and I'm going to let John's going to tell us his story, and then Todd is going to tell us his story, and we're going to have a little chat about our struggles.
I get to talk?
You
talk. Oh, great.
3 minutes.
So thanks for coming, everyone. I get a lot of questions on how did you get into this? How did you? I clearly have a very persuasive wife, and she has sort of, has not gone smoothly with us over the past 5 to 7 years along this course of our transition. Frankly, when this started, I worked a lot and I worked long days, and I wasn't around a lot for the kids' appointments, and, you know, knowing what the kids were doing on a daily basis, I wasn't really in tune to their sicknesses. You know, Anna knew every medication and doctor's appointment and what they did. And I kind of was peripherally aware that they were short people who lived in my house. So that's kind of the difference sometimes between moms and dads. So when Anna started mentioning that our kids were having these problems, I just didn't see it. And I said, oh, they're fine. They're kids. They get these things. It's going to go away. And I never really appreciated that our kids were sick. And I kind of dealt with, all right, we're going to eat more fruits and vegetables, and we're going to change the quality of some of the meats we're going to eat. But then she took away my Cheez-Its. And I don't know if you've ever had a Cheez-It. It's possibly the most fantastic crackers ever made. I mean, in my cracker hall of fame, it's top three, with chicken and biscuit and some others. Anyway, I love those types of processed foods and things. And that was a big part of my diet, believe it or not. And that was really the last straw for me. But I had a few aha moments, I think, that kind of started waking me up. So I'm an orthopedic surgeon, and I work pretty long hours, but I always consider myself healthy because I exercise a lot. And so my whole life, it's kind of been, well, if you exercise a lot, you can kind of eat what you want. And I've more been of a, eat to live than live to eat kind of guy. And I figured if I exercise enough, it's just calories. And yeah, certain foods may be a little bit healthier than others, but it's not like eating bad foods, it's harming you. It's not like it's drugs. And I don't believe that anymore. Growing up, I grew up kind of in the era of processed foods. And when I was a kid, I wanted to be Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan was my idol. And if you haven't watched The Last Dance, it's fantastic. But anyway, you want to be like Mike. And in the commercials, he drinks Gatorade and eats McDonald's. And that's what I wanted to be. And so after every basketball practice, we'd go get McDonald's and we'd drink our Gatorade because that's what Michael Jordan did. And so really, these kind of things were part of growing up and part of who I wanted to be, because I thought that's part of what you did to be a successful athlete. And so it really kind of put food in a certain perspective in my life that probably wasn't where it needed to be. So selfishly, I really didn't start to change or have these aha moments till I started getting sick. And I would get colds a lot, and she called them man colds. Because she said, you know, I was in bed and I couldn't get up and I was dramatic about it, which is completely untrue. But anyway, those happened. But then we were supposed to go on a big trip and I couldn't get out of bed. And I was coughing up blood. And my family, we didn't go to the doctor, and I refused to go to the doctor. And she said, you're not getting on a plane coughing up blood and seeing the doctor. And I had pneumonia. And that was what I thought was a healthy 35-year-old guy. And I said, all right, these guys, 35-year-old healthy guys don't get pneumonia. I mean, this is what old people get. And so that was a big wake-up call for me. And I said, something's wrong. Something's going on. The stress was out of control in my life. And that's when I kind of knew something had to change. And Anna had been talking to me about changing our lifestyle and our diet and the way we live for a long time, and I just didn't believe it. And so it really wasn't until it affected me personally that I really thought about changing. And then I started kind of slowly making these changes, and I started noticing some difference. Number one, the colds went away. Number two, so I work out a lot and I try to exercise. My joints would always kill me after these brutal workouts, particularly my knees and my feet. And when I started eating healthier, my joints didn't bother me as much. And I kind of was like, well, all right, maybe I'm onto something here. you know, it's kind of like, you know, it's kind of like my mom doesn't believe I'm a doctor. So if I tell her to do something, she doesn't believe me. And if your wife tells you, you don't believe her. But I actually read some books and thought, hey, Anna, I figured out this great thing about we should eat differently. And she's looking at me like she wants to kill me. And that's when we really, things started to change. And it was slow and it was brutal at first because, you know, a lot of these things I was giving up, they tasted fantastic and it was a cultural thing and I was very used to them. And so it was tough, but I started noticing, these great changes. A few of them, obviously not getting sick. I had very reactive skin. So people who have eczema notice this, I could take my fingernail along my arm and I would have a wheel and I could write my name in my arm and it would flare up. And I've had it my whole life and I would take Zyrtec multiple times a day to not have it. And when I changed my diet, it just stopped happening. And so I kept having these things happen and it really is what clued me in and to say, all right, this is the right path to take. I'm still learning and I'm still progressing with this and I still have relapses at times. but I think it's important. And if the pandemic hasn't shown us anything, what it's shown me is that here comes something where there's no pill. There's no quick fix. Your only thing you have is your immune system. And boy, am I glad that I decided to make these major changes because I feel like I can walk around there with the coronavirus and I feel like I have a shield and it's powerful to feel that way, that you've been doing the right stuff and you've got your immune system in the right place. And whether that's be to resolve your eczema or to be ready for when these things are attacking your body, I just feel, I feel great about that. So, well, anyway, it's been a long, arduous course. So that's my kind of quick history of how we got to where we're at.
Yeah, and I would just like to add that when he's working now, he flies to Indiana. So he flies on a plane in the midst of quarantine, and he works in the ICU where they have several COVID patients in Indiana. And he's come home and no one's freaking out and we're not panicked that, he, you know, everybody's like, what do you think? He's going to die. He's going to the ICU. And I'm like, so we feel for what we're doing, believe in what we're doing. So thank you for sharing. All right, Todd, tell us your story.
Yeah, absolutely. So I would say similarly, Lindsay's kind of been out in front a little bit, or should say a lot, when it comes to understanding how food affects her body. And she's been, or was gluten-free for years, even before our youngest son, Ridge, started developing eczema. So that happened when he was about a year and a half. And he started just getting a little kind of red, rough, itchy spots around his mouth. And I just thought it was because it was irritation from his pacifier. So naturally, we take that away and it's going to resolve itself. So we did that and it just got worse. So then I thought we needed to find some sort of cream. And so we found some cream. I don't know where we found the cream or what it was, started putting that on there and it didn't get any worse. So then we eventually took him to our pediatrician and got a prescription.
Our former pediatrician.
Yeah, sorry, former
not
pediatrician.
Not
I was getting there.
Okay.
And got a prescription for a steroid cream, which we actually never used on him because we just weren't comfortable with that. After several different eczema creams, didn't work, and got his eczema got so bad it kind of drifted up to his eyes and across his face, to where other little kids were making comments and asking what's wrong with his face. And that's really when we talk about an aha moment, like you mentioned, John. For me, that was where I was ready to be on board. Lindsay had been telling me for a while now, I think this might be food related. I think there might be a problem with his gut. And I really had no idea what she was talking about. And it didn't make sense. It's a skin problem. You put something on the skin, it should fix it. So it was around that same time that Lindsay obviously found Dr. Temple and set up our first meeting. And so we both went to that meeting together, and that really clued me into, okay, the reason why he's having these issues, which I assume are just skin irritation issues, were tracked back, well, even before he was born, back to the antibiotics that he was exposed to even during pregnancy and during that first year and a half of his life, and how that led to leaky gut, which led to the eczema, which really made it pretty simple as far as in my mind of how food can heal the gut, which is going to heal his skin. And so we started the food and supplement plan. This was something I had forgotten. Lindsay reminded me is that we were getting ready to go on vacation, right, to the beach, I think.
It was July and we had a beach trip planned. And you had suggested us starting gluten and dairy free as the initial thing, like before any supplements or anything like that. And Todd was like,
no, we're going on vacation. Now, why would we do that to ourselves?
And I said, you know, because sometimes the moms are more bossy. And I was like, no, we need to start it now. And I was like, I will make this work. I'll make paleo chocolate chip cookies to have some kind of treat on vacation. But we're going to do it. So I convinced him.
Yeah. So yeah, end of the story. We did start before they waited. And we actually saw results within 2 weeks, and I think, I mean, full results within 6-7 months, and yeah, we stuck with the plan. And obviously, we can go into more detail, and we slowly added some of those foods back into his diet. But that's really what kind of clued me into all of this and got us to dive in, you know, head first.
Yeah. Todd, it's nice to hear that you were a bit more receptive to the idea than I was. I have to admit, in retrospect, looking back, how much work it was for me to be the outlier and not agree to go along with this, because I didn't agree. I said, you can do whatever you want with the kids. I'm not, this is BS. I'm not doing it. So it was twice the work. So the kids would, you know, would be gluten free. And I literally would have a bag of crackers at the table. And so
we still like regular bread in the house, and then gluten-free bread, you know. It wasn't like
I wasn't perfect by any means.
No, there was beer in the fridge.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I understand. I'll say I was dead weight to the whole project. And so I guess what I'd say to the dads out there is that you know, we do all these things as a family, and this one is key to do as a family, to try to do this separated, to separate out certain kid. Oh, they're going to do this versus that. It's really tough to do. And you can come together as a family in so many ways for different things. And I guess it just never occurred to me, all right, this would be a thing we come together as a family on, but this was actually the most important thing to come together on as a family. It just takes some of us longer to realize that than others. So.
For sure. Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I mean, that was something that Lindsay and I were talking about in preparation for this, is that so often dads, especially, we say we would do anything for our families and sacrifice anything unless it's eat more vegetables or anything.
That is so true.
And the other thing I thought about is that, you know, I'm one of these people who researches everything, right? So, you know, before I go to Lowe's, I'm researching whether I'm getting a smooth shank nail or a ring shank, and I'll sit there and I'll evaluate these wood screws for 15 minutes. But at the grocery store, I would just pile in whatever. I wouldn't even ever look. And in retrospect, you look back and it's like, it's amazing. I could care less what I put in my body, but I spend all this time researching, you know, wood screws or whatever. So it just didn't make sense. And so I guess I would challenge the dads out there. I said, you know, why is quality so much more important in other things, but we don't require the same amount of quality with what's fueling us? It just doesn't make sense. And I can say that in retrospect, I didn't appreciate the time, but I guess I would tell you to think about that hard for a while, because it's eye-opening once you think about it.
For sure. I agree.
Anything else? Because we're going to go, what we'll do next is we're going to do finances as the next obstacle, which I think is also important in our dads, because, and then we're going to go to picky eaters, because that was also a lot of questions on that. Does that sound good for you guys?
Mm-hmm. That's great.
I'm going to leave the chat open. So if you guys have any questions, I'm leaving the chat open, so feel free. I have a teeny tiny presentation on finances, very small, and we're going to start with this meme that was found by John, of course, the differences between moms and dads. If you see the mom over here reading the labels with the bored child, but just moving on. And then dad piling on processed foods on top of the child to just move on with a grocery the trip.
The kids used to be so excited if I was going grocery shopping. Like, dad's going. It was like a celebration.
Dad shopping, and when dad was in charge, then it was takeout and pizza. But in one of the things requested from our mamas in our eczema course, I wanted to get a breakdown of how much does it cost? Because oftentimes people say being healthy is really expensive. Taking this course is expensive. You don't understand finances. I'm like, all right, well, let's take a look. So this mama, we pulled some things. This is one example of a mom who has reasonable insurance, and her pediatrician skin consults were $57. That was after the insurance covered something. And so every time she went, which was many, many times, it was $57 each time. Her allergy consult and skin prick testing was $364, and she had to do that twice. Dermatologist visits were $50, and that was three visits, and medications were $200. The point of this being that we look often with our insurance cards, we give the dermatologist our insurance card, and we say, and then we get seen, we don't pay anything, and then 3 months later, we get a bill in the mail for the visit, let's say the $364. Often the person taking the children to the doctor is not the one paying the bills, if that's the way it worked in our household. And so that becomes an even bigger disconnect, because now it seems like you're not really paying anything for the dermatologist, and the person paying the bills doesn't even know what that was. So there's a huge disconnect in how much money is actually going in the care of the children. And when we start looking at this, it really becomes poignant, because dads are, and correct me guys if I'm wrong, and Todd, I'm going to stop the slideshow, but one of the things was that dads look at the bottom line, right? You're always on the spreadsheet, and I'm speaking for me myself. Oftentimes, yeah, I'm aware of the money, but often I feel like it's Monopoly money. I'm not balancing the checkbook every single time. You know, he sits around and he's like checking the credit card and yells at all the people around our house because we have teenagers. He's like, Allie, why so many Uber rides? Anna, what, you know, and we get yelled at. We're like, oh, dad's running the credit card. So I thought it would be really important to run the numbers of what just one child who is very young, actually, what their medical bills are just from a year and a half of eczema care. So Todd, any thoughts on the finances?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think to some of that on the budget side, you have to come together. I mean, that was for us was the, it was the conversation that we had prior to that. You know, the goal in mind is helping our son and helping our family to become healthier. And so I think if that line of open communication is there and you set the proper expectations that, yeah, if you look line item, kind of the pay at the pump price at the grocery store, it's going to cost a little bit more. But having the perspective of the long term, like you just mentioned, that is probably going to be lower overall costs in general, just for having a more healthy immune system. Mm-hmm. And that's something that we've had to have open conversations about, of our priorities on basically groceries, which most people don't have those types of discussions. But yet we're willing to spend a little bit more at the grocery store and maybe sacrifice in some other areas where we need to within the budget, whether it's, you know, entertainment or this, you know, club membership or gym membership or whatever it is. And that's just kind of been a priority, but it's all about the line of communication, making sure you guys are on the same page about that.
And we, you know, it is overall health is the goal. So we haven't had to go to the doctors much. We haven't had to buy like a ton of Tylenol and ibuprofen, like you mentioned when we were talking earlier, and you know, all the other different things that you might get at a drugstore, because we see food as medicine now, especially since all this happened with Rich. And I know you guys do too. And so it's like, we see that as like the way that we keep ourselves healthy and our immune system strong. So it makes it worth it. It's just like a little bit of a shift we had to make to realize it was okay to spend a little bit more at the grocery store or farmer's market or whatever, wherever.
And I will say on that though, what I think is difficult for most dads is that we are wired somewhat to be fixers of things. And so that model of paying a copay and getting prescription and equals solution in our mind. And so that's an easy way versus a process that's a little bit more kind of longer term and maybe not quite as black and white. And so I think for some dads, I'm included, I kind of like the, I can pay this copay, get a prescription and it's fixed. And I had to certainly shift my mindset in that way.
Yeah, we have somebody on the webinar that actually that's one of their biggest battles is that dad is suffering from a skin issue and he goes to the dermatologist and he gets skin injections, so immunosuppressants. And therefore he's like, well, why would my daughter be any different? Because I go to the doctor, I get immunosuppressants. Therefore that's her treatment plan too, which is very difficult. Because to your point, it's like, well, if it's good enough for me, then it's good enough for my daughter, because the mindset has not been shifted about that.
Yeah.
And I think what Todd said about just making it a priority is the ultimate difference, because for me, food has always been, since I've been on my own, it has been my flex item in my budget. So when times are lean, I eat cheap food, and when times are better, I eat a little better. So it's, food has always been my flexible aspect to the budget. And when you start thinking of food is essentially as your medicine, as your what's going to keep you healthy, it puts it up in the priority list. So it becomes, it's like what most people consider their cell phone. Oh, I can't change my cell phone plan. That's the most important thing I have.
Right.
I'll eat garbage if I can have my cell phone, right? So you got to put food in that position, because you learn that, well, that's where the priority lies. That's my medication. That's going to keep me healthy. That's what's going to strengthen my immune system. And so it changes. Yeah. The other thing is that if you guys are like we were, my practice went to a high deductible plan. And so our yearly deductible was $12,000. And so previously I wasn't seeing all these little things at the beginning, all these little appointments and all these little medications. But when you get a $12,000 deductible, I started seeing all those. So being a bottom line guy, I said, hey, why are we getting all these, you know, all these little costs and things? And that's when it started making a difference that, hey, maybe if we eat healthier, we stop some of these, you know, every month appointment to the pediatrician, which is 150 bucks a piece. And it ultimately saves you money if you can think big picture. And so I think that's where you can say, all right, yeah, it's a little bit more on the front end, but you're going to get that back multiplied on the back end. So,
right.
Yeah. Especially if you're starting when your child's young, it's better to get them healthy from the get-go, and then you don't have to deal with that, the financial aspect of it, or just all the doctor's visits forever, you know?
Good. Right. Exactly. Yeah. And a lot of times we're worried, I think, too, in finances, like, oh, well, if I want to eat, if I want to change the food, then it's going to be a higher cost, because if you go gluten-free, if you go dairy-free, if you go, you know, it's exhausting and it costs more. And at times it does, but it all depends on the processed foods that you go on. So you do have to think a little more outside the box. Because if you buy this, so that is what we do in our course. We actually sit and work with you. If you're like, hey, listen, I'm struggling to find these foods, we help you figure out how to make better choices and that are also more economical. Because there's ways. There's not, you know, everybody makes it believe that if you go to Wendy's. So in one of my blog posts, I took organic beef from Costco, organic buns, organic cheese, and I broke down the prices. So if you make an organic burger at home, it's actually cheaper than a burger from Wendy's. But the people go, oh, well, it's $3 versus $60 grocery bill, right? Which then $3, $60. But that's one burger versus like 20 some burgers, depending, you know, how you break it down. But you do have to put the effort into making it, which is also difficult because we are all not only about finances. Quit. We were too busy. Well, we were really busy and we were doing 1,000 things and nobody had time to cook. So one good part of the quarantine is we are all at home and cooking more. And Lindsay has been doing such an amazing job in the course, walking with everybody through the different meal ideas, where you get your food, where, because it is about finances. To say finances don't matter, that's silly, but I do agree with priorities. I mean, we got rid of, before we left for New Zealand, we had to do financial changes, right? And so we got rid of cable. When he quit his job in Charlotte and I started my clinic, we're like, okay, well, the food, we're like, okay, how about the country club goes, you know? And it was like all these different things, and the food was always mentioned to be on the chopping block. And then we miraculously found all these other things that could be taken away, and we're very happy people anyway. So that's just another how we tackled the finances on our side.
Yeah, we've done some of that adjusting to, like, cutting cable and things like that. And, you know, it's been things like that seem to be better anyways to make those decisions. It's just sometimes a little bit of a, I don't know, sticky point to get there, but then it's worth it after you do it. So.
Yep. Do we want to move on to picky eaters?
Yeah. And I also want to say one thing too, that we, in the course, we see it as like a community, and the moms that are in it, you know, all give their input, and like, I found really good, affordable such and such from here. And there's websites you can order food from too. It's and groceries. It's not just like you have to go to Whole Foods and spend $500 on groceries. There's other options, and it's nice to have people from within the course doing it together and like giving feedback. So the other moms help each other as well, which is nice.
I totally agree. And it's because we were talking earlier, like you become isolated. You know that there's a solution for your child's eczema or your child's illness, but no one's listening to you. And you've talked to a million doctors, no one's listening to you. You've done a million blog searches, but is that really good for you? And no one, you know, talk to your friends, they're like, you're weird, just do whatever. And I think in this community, what we found is everyone is speaking the same language. Everyone is doing the same struggle. Everyone is doing this together. And I think that the community is what's really missing in the traditional, well, many things, but one of the things missing in the traditional plan, because you're right. When somebody puts out a recipe, my daughter and I have made several recipes that I was perusing our Facebook group, and I was like, oh, chickpea salad, never thought of it. Made it. We thought it was a huge hit, like molasses cookies. Oh, didn't think about that. We have all those ingredients. And it's just so nice to have people that they're all speaking the same allergy friendly talk. So no one is suggesting that we're going to go to Chick-fil-A and why don't you eat mac and cheese? It's like, oh, you want mac and cheese? Okay, here's a version that your kids could eat, which helps all the mamas. And I've taken some notes.
Yeah.
But it's nice to see that, you know, many of these people, they're the only one in their peer group who has looked at making these changes for their child. And so it's isolating when you don't have anyone to bounce these things off. So creating the community, I think, and the Facebook group, it's been nice to see that grow. So you feel like you have people that are going through this and making these changes with you, and you have partners in that. And so it's been nice to see, actually.
Yeah, I love it. I'm the health coach for it, that I learned from the other moms too. So it's been really positive. But with picky eaters, I think one message I get a lot is like, I don't know if I can do this because my daughter or son is so picky and won't eat anything. And our approach to that is, one, as we talked about earlier, as a family and as parents start to learn about how food is medicine, and if we have that foundation in our minds, that it helps to translate into what the kids eat too. And a lot of times the biggest picky eaters, and this feedback that we get a lot is, you know, these guys. And so they have to be the examples. And we've already addressed that some. So as long as the guys or the husband's dads take kind of a leadership role, if the kids see the dad eating broccoli or mushrooms, like you were talking about earlier, they're going to look at the table and say like, oh, dad's eating it, I can try it too. So as long as dad's on board, it seems to help the process. So
I agree. And as dad is not making snarky comments in the background.
Yeah,
right. Why can't you have fun food? You should have fun food. Why come they can't have fun food? Let me eat. Let me bring my Pop-Tarts home. He wasn't Pop-Tart guy. But I have some patients that all of a sudden, we're on a Zoom call, and she's in the pantry. She's like, look, we're just now. Pop-Tarts. You take away. So one of the biggest reasons kids whine and are picky is if the food is in here, if it's in the pantry. So if you have Pop-Tarts in the pantry, they're going to cry and whine about the Pop-Tarts. If the Pop-Tarts are gone, they don't generally, except mine are older teenagers, but generally most of the people in our eczema court, the kids don't have driver's licenses and they have no money. So they can't go to the grocery store. They're not even allowed in grocery stores now. So all you have to say is they ran out of Pop-Tarts. They don't know. We just told them there's a virus. We also tell them it's Santa Claus. And all of a sudden you're like, but I can't lie to them about Cheerios. You know what I mean? Like, there's a tooth fairy. I think we can lie about the gluten-free bread. It's okay. But I think that if we make it that's the rule in the house and this is just the food that we have, mm-hmm. Children have opinions. We should listen to their opinions. But when it comes to food, they are not the mainstay. You know, I think give them too much power in the food world, especially when they're suffering. They don't have the right to know at 4 and at 6 and at 8, 12. They don't have the mental capacity to understand what that really means. That is my take on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. And we've had certainly our battles with picky eaters and I mean, it's definitely battles, not it's not easy. And sometimes they go to bed hungry.
Yeah.
Because they're not eating with
them. Yeah, we got it.
But I've never seen a child starve with food sitting in front of them. So
right.
Parents, you know, it's amazing. They're like, oh, you know, he's going to starve. He's going to go to bed hungry. I'm like, he might be hungry, but he's not going to starve. Kids will ultimately eat if they're hungry enough. And it doesn't matter what it is. I mean, that's the bottom line.
Yeah. And I was sharing too with you that I have one patient recently that she was going to bed and she would vomit. She would get herself so hungry. She would literally vomit in the morning. And the mom called me in a panic and she was like, she's vomiting from the starvation. And I was like, she does not have a stomach bug. This is, she's good. I was like, literally, she's good. She's going to take over the world. But right now it's highly annoying. So we're not going to believe her. And I said, the options are you eat and you don't vomit, or you don't eat and you vomit. And now she's trying new foods. And it lasted 2 days. The mom stayed strong, but it took her a couple of years to be able to get to that level. And that's okay, because this is a journey. And if your child is really picky, you don't have to change everything tomorrow. We can do a little bit at a time. This is not a sprint. This is a marathon.
Yeah. And we work with moms to help that transition, or parents to help with that transition. It's not like a overnight, our kids are eating grass, you know, it's, we do it slowly and we offer substitutions and we have so many snack ideas and recipes and things like that. So it's not, we can like give tips in the course to transition them out of these bad eating habits. And for us, like our oldest Davis, he's 7 now, but it took him a while to get to where he's a really good eater. It wasn't overnight, a lot of consistency and work from us, but it was so worth it. I mean, in the long run, especially. So, yeah.
And I think too, in the community, people are talking about it and they have struggles and the mamas support each other and they show pictures. I'm like, this is my success story. And when you see people doing well, again, more positivity and less negativity, you're like more inspired. You're like, oh, well, they can do it. Okay, we'll get there. Maybe we're not here. Okay, two of them are here, not the other two. But seeing positive people putting positive pictures of their kids who before were not eating a produce and now the mama can't keep up with produce from Costco because they're eating her out of house and home. I mean, it makes my heart so happy. But it's with all the different changes. But again, it takes a community to be able to overcome picky eaters. But picky eaters is a first world problem. Mm-hmm. This does not exist in Haiti, you know?
Yeah.
Tell them, I've always found it interesting. Tell them how taste buds work and how to get picky eaters to try foods. I've always found that always helped me when I was trying to get a kid to eat something. So.
Right. Yeah. So the taste buds die between every 2 weeks to 30 days, depending on your body. But if you say every 30 days, so a third of your taste buds die in 30 days, by 90 days, all your taste buds have changed. So if you were to eat, let's say broccoli, and it's disgusting. Eventually the taste buds go, oh, that's what we're eating. So we're going to start changing depending on the broccoli. And all of a sudden by 90 days, let's say in a worst case scenario, the child's taste buds are no longer offended by broccoli. When your child's taste buds are always doing mac and cheese, chicken nuggets, listen, we did all of that. And you do Pop Tarts and Cinnamon Toast Crunch, the taste buds are expecting an explosion of flavor. Mm-hmm. These are all chemicals. So the taste buds are like, I want to be excited. I want to have a party. And it's always a party. And then you give them broccoli and they're like, it's the worst. This is like the worst party ever. But with persistence and removing the junk, the taste buds that were so happy over there, they leave. They don't want to be here. So they die. And within 90 days, you eat broccoli tastes good, and then you'll eat like a Lay's potato chip, and the flavor is so intense. I'm not saying it's not good, but it's so incredibly intense. You're like, wow, I had no idea, because they've changed to what you're training your taste buds to the food. It's not the other way around.
Yeah, and we talk about that with sugar in the course too, because if you're used to eating it, you crave sugar, and if you cut it out, you realize how sweet things are, like fruit or something, if you haven't been eating sugar. So we talk about that in the course too, and how to gradually transition that out. It doesn't have to be like you go completely change your pantry like the night you start this course.
Right. You have a revolution in your house.
Right.
Yeah.
So we're happy to take, we have 5 minutes to take questions. Laura has placed an amazing, thank you for your testimonial, Laura. That is makes my heart so happy. So if you guys have any questions on things that we did not cover, feel free to send them here. I did put an offer for 20% off. The discount is, the promo code is DAD20, and you'll get 20% off the course. The course is $497. If you press the button on that offer, it takes you to our landing page so you can get more information. This is not... our webinar, this is not designed to talk about what the course is doing. We have a different webinar for that. It's 20 minutes. We wanted to really tackle roadblocks. Hey, Carrie Ann, besides gluten and dairy, could you recommend the next food you eliminate? So the thing is not about, that is actually our step. No, that's actually step two in our program. We do other eliminations first, then we go to gluten and dairy, and then we actually move on to supplements that are really necessary to help kids heal with eczema. And then if the children are not doing well on the supplements, then we move to another round of eliminations and we move on to gut healing supplements. So it's a very specific stepwise approach. We don't want to just eliminate food, because that's not the whole answer. That is only one piece of the puzzle. We need to rebalance. We need to reintroduce. We need to reorganize the gut. There's a lot of R's that have to come in to put it all together, because we don't want children to be intolerant to these foods forever. This is a temporary thing. So I don't have a simple answer, because the course goes in a very specific step approach. Sorry if you mentioned already, would this course work for 6 month old babies, strictly breastfed? Yes, Carolyn, we have several moms in the course that are strictly breastfeeding babies who have not had food yet, and it is working for them as well. And you actually end up doing a lot of the supplements and gut healing, because if your child's gut is a mess, that means your gut is a mess. And so we go hand in hand. So the beautiful thing is actually you do the course, one course for the whole family. Right, because everybody benefits. You take everyone with you. And I'm always, people are like, should I give the other ones the supplements? I'm like, well, why do you only love this one more? I'm like, well, if it's good for this one, they're like, everybody's on the same pattern. And usually all the ducklings like to line up and they're like, what is he doing? What's she doing? How come they get this?
Yeah, our oldest does not like to miss out on supplements that Ridge got. So, or not all of them, but a lot of them. And then you got healthier in the process as well. And I was going to say too, we were able to work gluten and dairy back in for Ridge. It's not like that just to heal his gut. It took a while, and then we were able to work those foods back in. So it wasn't like he had an allergy necessarily. So it's nice that there's that freedom now that he can have, like, if he goes to a birthday party, I don't have to flip out now about what he's going to eat and worry that he's going to have a flare because his gut healed. So now he can handle those foods, which is really nice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Awesome. Do you have to be a patient from IHCU to join the course? And if you are a patient, does it include the course as a patient? Awesome question. You do not need to be a patient of our clinic to do it. And our membership does not include the course. What we do in clinic is we actually do a very intensive, we do food allergy testing, stool testing. We go way deep. So for people that are trying this approach and are not successful, this is going to be helpful for the majority of people, but there's always severely affected folks that are just going to need more intensive treatment. If you come see us, we're actually doing testing. We're doing stool, a lot of gut healing, but it is a lot more intensive because the kids are a lot sicker.
And I will say that she was seeing such amazing results in her patients in her office. And she said, I just wish we could help so many people with this because the basic structure is the same. And that's kind of why I said, let's make a course. There's so many people that can be helped by this if we give them the tools to do it. And so that's kind of why we started this, is for patients who are not in the practice who we think we could really help. So
yeah, and it's becomes, because the other thing too with the pandemic, finances have become a big issue for a lot of families, and this gives people an option to help heal their kids without having to break the bank. Worse, I'm the worst foreigner, worse. And do you recommend the course for parents with a child with anaphylactic food allergies that is already on a restricted diet but is still suffering from eczema, or do you recommend one-on-one consult working with limited budget? Amy, I would say very limited budget is going to be the course, because we do work with kids that have several kids in our course have anaphylaxis. And in fact, they went down the steps and have seen more results than they have ever seen from their allergists with this course, right? Am I right, Lindsay?
Yeah. I don't want to make stuff up. We definitely have people who can't have lots of things, mm-hmm. but definitely like nuts and eggs that really bother people, and they're still able to do this course. It's such an overall take on it. It's not just the foods that they're allergic to. So yeah, I would say they could definitely do the course, especially with a limited budget, because you're already familiar. If you're used to anaphylactic food allergies, you're already familiar with shopping according to allergies. So that's one big, mark off the checklist.
Yeah, we work with that. That's the recipes that we have, that you provide, the snack ideas we provide, usually our top 8 allergen friendly, because we have so many people with different allergies from all over the place.
And that's also why we incorporated these live episodes on Facebook every week, so that these specific things can be brought up, because we just didn't want everyone floating out there kind of at sea on their own. And so that's why each week you have an opportunity to say, hey, my situation's this, and you can ask these questions. And so that you would be a great person for the Facebook Lives to say, hey, I'm in this particular situation. What do you think? And it gives you an opportunity to work through those problems.
Right. But yeah, I'm glad you said that, because this, since we're not doing it about the course, that's a tidbit we don't. So what happens is you not only have a course with curriculum, with what supplements, with bundles and all that, but every Monday, Lindsay is on Facebook Live at 2 p.m. and she talks about all the food challenges, lifestyle challenges, because not just food. And then on Thursdays at 2 o'clock, I'm on Facebook Live with everybody, and we tackle more of the medical aspect of things like supplement, gut healing, what's going on, you know, do again, more of a medical thing. So then we know that you have two touch points every week, so you're not out there despairing, because it is hard. And one of the things we're talking about today too, that recovery is not a straight line. You're like, oh, I'm doing this course, awesome, sweet. It is like, and eventually you get up there. So that's why it's nice to pair up with a whole team, not just you and a blog. That's really hard.
Yeah.
Carrie-Anne, is the course designed to help the family as a whole or more focused on the person suffering? It is designed for you to work on it however you want to. I would say a lot of the families just do the whole family, because it is so much easier.
Yeah, they've had, I mean, I know some of the moms have had good results in the kids that they weren't even focused on. So, and we have all ages. We have babies, teenagers, we have adults doing this who have seen results. So I would say whole family is, you know, seems to benefit.
Well, you know, I'm always like, but if we're seeing that one, somebody's having an issue, that's usually a flag, because that one human was created by two humans, and the two humans most likely have some issues that they've passed on to the small human. And so, you know, we're like, oh, I'm good. I'm like, well, don't wait till you have cancer, and don't wait till you have heart disease. Mm-hmm. Like, do the course now. This is great for everything. It's top secret, but this is actually the same course for asthma and other issues, because this helps it all. That's why everyone's like, I can't believe that my kid with stomach pain no longer has stomach pain. I'm like, yeah, I know, because that's actually the same course. Yeah. So does anybody have else? Otherwise, we're going to sign off, team, because, all right. Well, we appreciate everybody being here. I will let you know as a last thing that you can chat with us for 15 minutes. We do a free consultation. If you have any other questions about the course, email us at info@integrativehealthcourses.com. We can send you a webinar about what the eczema course is really about, if you're interested, but please feel free to give us a call. We're so excited that you joined us, and thank you so much, and I hope everybody stays safe. And
there's one more question. And to piggyback on that, if people registered, will they be able to see it later?
If you register, the recording will come out in 24 hours.
Okay.
Yes.
And we will we'll republish this webinar and a link. So for Ania, if you've just arrived, we can make this available.
Just arrived, 4-year-old who had terror. Okay, yes. So Ania, since you're going to see the recording of this, and also on YouTube under Dr. Anna Maria Temple, you'll see the eczema webinar. But I can send you a link. I can put the link in here. If you can see, I don't know that that's going to work out. I'll send it.
Yeah,
forget it. Ah! Okay. Sorry, I was trying to be really techie and that did not work out. So Ania, just click on the course button, and then that way gives you to contact us, and we will send you the webinar for the eczema part. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you guys so much. And again, thank you everyone.
Thank you.
I'm glad this was helpful. Have a good night.
Yes.